The Formula One teams had completed a full winter's testing and development by the time they got to Phoenix for the first Grand Prix of the year. For some, the future stretched ahead, barren and uncertain. Others hoped to blossom into genuine contenders. Some already were. Phoenix was the initial proving ground, a difficult, bumpy street circuit with very hard walls. Temporary accommodation trackside erected for the spectators, and the track itself taking a repeated hammering over the weekend from the cars, turning a weak spot into a pothole. World champion Ayrton Senna returned to McLaren after an unusually long winter's break. Most of the testing done by Gerhard Berger, and neither of them rated the new Honda V12 very highly. How important now the management skills of Ron Dennis in charge of the championship favourites. According to him, Ferrari had come out top of the winter testing. Three times world champion Alain Prost was their number one, partnered by the French-Sicilian Jean Alesi, recruited from Tyrrell after contractual battles with almost every other team in Formula One. Phoenix was where he'd impressed in 1990, holding off Ayrton Senna for first place for some 34 laps.
You know, I think we work very hard all the winter. We have a very competitive car. Now we have to race and to see what will happen.
After 2 years at Ferrari, Nigel Mansell was back at Williams. He'd been persuaded to change his mind about retirement by Frank Williams. Mansell convinced he had the package to win races with the ever-improving Renault engine, the vital ingredient.
I'll make a statement and say for sure we're going to win some races. I don't think there's any question about that, but you know, we've just got to see if we can be reliable. The car was late coming off the line, and we are suffering even today because of that. But as I said, everyone's pushing very hard. There's no lack of effort anywhere in the team, and we have just got to be patient and hope that it all comes together for us. And if it does, then who knows?
Riccardo Patrese, the most experienced Formula One Grand Prix driver of all time, 208 Grand Prix and 3 wins going into the 1991 season. Weighing in for his 14th Grand Prix year and his second with Benetton, Nelson Piquet. Three times world champion, partnered by his Brazilian teammate and great friend Roberto Moreno. Benetton had finished off the 1990 season with a flourish, wins in Japan and Australia. They were in optimistic mood, the only one of the top teams running on Pirelli tyres, and they had designer John Barnard, with his reputation for innovation and winning. Tyrrell anticipated their best season for years, powered by the Honda V10 and designed by the former Ferrari man Harvey Postlethwaite. The talented Stefano Modena was expected at last to fulfil his potential. The Formula One newcomers Jordan had as team principal the charismatic Irishman Eddie Jordan. They graduated through Formula 3000 and they produced for Formula One a sleek car that ran as smartly as it looked.
Is it more difficult than Formula 3000?
I'll tell you after pre-qualifying tomorrow, but of course it is. There are 15, 16 world-class teams here. They're the best in the world. They've got all very good budgets. They have got excellent drivers. They know exactly what they're doing. Technology in terms of the design, all excellent. I have to believe that our own is particularly good as well. So from that point of view, I feel that on the team side that we're in very good shape.
Jordan's drivers, Bertrand Gachot, he had brief race experience with Onyx, Real and Coloni, and Andrea De Cesaris, 150 Grand Prix but only 38 points. Another newcomer to the Grand Prix scene, Modena, like Jordan, forced initially to pre-qualify. Lamborghini built both engines and cars. Charged with the task of leading the team, the Italian Nicola Larini, while his teammate was the Belgian Eric van der Poel, tasting Formula One for the first time, having progressed through Formula 3000. Just like Mark Blundell of Britain, here with his Brabham teammate Martin Brundle. Brundle, of course, determined to be number one. The Finn Mika Hakkinen, the British Formula 3 champion, he made his Formula One debut with Lotus. Frenchman Eric Comas, the Formula 3000 champion, came into Formula One with Ligier, where he partnered the vastly experienced Thierry Boutsen, and Pedro Chaves from Portugal. He attempted to make his name at Coloni, but at Phoenix at least, he was doing it for all the wrong reasons in pre-qualifying. That became a familiar sight in the 1991 season. Ayrton Senna took pole position at Phoenix, a second quicker than anyone else, despite his reservations about the Honda V12 engine. Alongside him on the front row, Alain Prost, the Ferrari, he said, not suited to the Phoenix streets. Riccardo Patrese was the best of the rest, out-qualifying his teammate Nigel Mansell for third place on the grid. A broken driveshaft hampered Mansell's progress on his return to Williams, although Alain Prost was just one driver who was said to be impressed with the new Williams Renault. Nelson Piquet qualified fifth, almost 2 seconds slower than Ayrton Senna, while Jean Alesi, having set his quickest time in the Friday session, then suffered a most embarrassing moment, with influential eyes observing. Alesi's slide and collision into the wall left the Ferrari team with plenty to occupy them overnight. But it wasn't just the young Chargers that found Phoenix a handful. Here we're on board with Gerhard Berger, backwards at 100 miles an hour. Eventually, he set the seventh fastest time. So now on to the race itself. Your commentator, Simon Taylor.
Thanks, Andy. Yes, the first green light of the season, and Ayrton Senna started as he meant to go on, out-accelerating Prost's Ferrari and the Williams Renaults. But Prost was slotting neatly into second place from Mansell and Patrese, with Berger and Alesi and the Benettons in hot pursuit. As always, the unyielding walls of Phoenix required accuracy as well as speed, but Ayrton had plenty of both, and he had no trouble in pulling out a big lead. The new McLaren was looking like a winner from race one. As the rest of the field gave chase, there were problems further back. Mika Häkkinen had a strange one. He'd knocked his steering wheel release, and unable to steer the car, had this mighty spin. Behind second man Prost, Riccardo Patrese went for Mansell's third place and came off worst in the ensuing Williams brake test. But he recovered quickly from his mistake and rejoined in sixth place. Mark Blundell was less lucky with his Brabham. He'd spun into retirement.
I was enjoying it very much. We had a few problems, a bit of an engine problem, very low on power. But looking at the car, there's a lot of oil on the back of our car, so the car broke away quite suddenly. It won't surprise me if it's had a leak and we've spun in our own oil.
Then it was all over for Nigel Mansell. The Williams' new electronic gearbox had failed, the first blow in a character-building season for Nigel. The McLaren of Gerhard Berger, lying fifth, lost fuel pressure and then all power and needed a push. And then second man Prost had a disastrous tyre stop with the Ferrari. Watch the mechanics on the right rear wheel. This stop lost him so much time that he rejoined in sixth place. But then disaster struck the new second man, Patrese. His Williams' gearbox had failed and spun him out. And it was also the end of Roberto Moreno's race. There he is, running across the zebra crossing to a position of safety. Take a look at what happened. Patrese spins, and then Moreno's Benetton joins the heap before Riccardo can get out of the cockpit and escape. It could have been very much worse. Bertrand Gachot had the Jordan up to seventh in its first race until this spin across the bows of Alesi. Alesi got through safely, but Nelson Piquet was next along, and he nearly got involved as Gachot recovered. Mika Häkkinen, who'd had his steering wheel tightened up, finally called it a day. And then we had a great battle for second as Alesi was caught by Piquet and teammate Prost. And this is how Prost went from fourth to second in one wonderful manoeuvre. He's behind Piquet, Alesi's the other side, and then he squeezes between the two of them and he has the inside line for the right-hander that follows. And that's Jean Alesi's eye view of the battle. The Jordan debut ended when Gachot's engine blew and he parked behind Martini's Minardi. And so, almost unnoticed, Senna drove on to a comfortable win in the McLaren. opening his account in exactly the way he'd wanted. And with both Williams Renaults succumbing to gearbox trouble, their Achilles heel was already evident.
So an opening 10 points for the defending champion. Prost relieved to gain 6 from a circuit he never enjoyed. Piquet delighted, both Tyrrells showing, and a useful point for LaRousse, plus a few more made later by Senna.
Now the car is ready. The performance speaks for itself. It's a brand new car. We never run full Grand Prix distance with this, with full tank. Today was the first time, and we win a race like this with a lot of lead. So it's a great performance. The car is reliable too. The engine also run very, very well. I had just small problems with the gearbox and a question of keeping on the road, staying away from the wall, coming for tires at the right moment. At the start was very important. So things went very well for us. Our car is, although it's running well, is still, I think, a long way from being right. It's only a question of us having the opportunity to set up it properly and learn about it better. And we know that the engine is going to improve too. It's a question of time that Honda will come up with a higher performance engine.
Two Brazilians in the top three, a result that set up the next race perfectly. As 2 weeks later, the scene shifted south to Ayrton Senna's hometown, Sao Paulo. On the road to the Interlagos circuit that hosted the Grand Prix for the second successive year, Senna had never won here or in Rio. A home victory was long overdue in the eyes of the thousands of fans who gathered to glimpse only one man, their world champion, Ayrton Senna. A rarity indeed, a prophet with honour in his own land.
It's always good to be home, but it's extra pressure, of course. I like very much to win here if I can. I've been near to do it many times in the past, but for a number of different reasons, we weren't able to do it. So let's hope this weekend we can do something better.
To say the least, the weather was not good all weekend. Black clouds threatened as soon as any sunny periods developed. And in the rain, Ferrari, after their 15-second-plus effort in Phoenix, tried to smooth out the system. Pit stop practice designed to reduce time on the jacks to around 7 seconds. More rain in free practice, Nigel Mansell, the man caught out, damaging the front end of his Williams. Berger in the second McLaren, fighting for grip and not finding any. Just one disconcerting moment at a notoriously slippery corner. It also claimed Moreno's Benetton. Fortunately, without serious damage to car or Brazilian driver. The corner also accounted for Jean Alesi, the young Ferrari driver having his bright promise tarnished again. The focus of attention played his part to the full. Ayrton Senna eclipsed his rivals in the Friday session more than half a second faster around the 2.7-mile circuit than Jean Alesi. Come Saturday, the track was conducive to faster times. Mansell in the Williams Renault, on one flyer, clocked an incredibly rapid lap. His teammate Riccardo Patrese was the first to respond. And it had all the signs of spoiling the celebration party planned for Senna. But in that now familiar fashion, Senna set a target, achieved it. 116.393 assured him of pole position and gave Mansell plenty of food for thought. Senna, in a car that he was still not completely satisfied with, seemingly from nowhere had produced a pole-winning lap. The adulation given to Mansell in Britain is reserved for Senna at Interlagos. Senna knew it wouldn't have been possible without his team pulling out all the stops.
The fact that Williams has demonstrated to be so fast, it really put me going, because I don't think under normal conditions we could have beaten them for a qualifying lap.
Senna on pole, Mansell third, while Riccardo Patrese was delighted with his own performance in the Williams that ensured a place on the front row for the first time this season.
It was close, but not enough. But anyway, I think I'm very satisfied with the performance of the team, Williams and Renault. I think they did a great job during the winter, and they provide a car that I think is going to be competitive for the rest of the season. That is the most important thing. And apart from that, today I drove well. I think I did my best. I couldn't go any quicker, so Ayrton did the pole. Congratulations to him.
The Ferraris were a distant fifth and sixth in qualifying, Jean Alesi ahead of Alain Prost. Both were determined to do better in the race.
Well, the dramas began on the grid with Berger's McLaren catching fire, but the race went ahead. And as the lights went to green, it was Senna ahead, with Mansell and Patrese wheel-to-wheel for second, then the smoking Berger, and the Ferraris of Alesi and Prost, and Nelson Piquet's Benetton. Berger's fire seemed to blow itself out, and on down the hill went the field, with the Dallara of Emanuele Pirro getting off the road and onto the grass, but somehow staying in the race. So Senna had the lead. But right from the start, there was real pressure from Mansell, which kept up all the way until the routine tyre stops. Senna and Mansell made theirs without changing positions, but Patrese, Berger and Alesi in third, fourth and sixth places all came in on the same lap. This is Patrese's stop. Behind him are Alesi and Berger. And the Ferrari mechanics have to move extremely quickly. Watch for the men in the yellow shirts as the red and white car starts to move. Meanwhile, Nelson Piquet was trying to go the full distance on one set of Pirellis, but the reshod Patrese was soon stealing his third place. Prost, very unhappy with the number 27 Ferrari, had to make a second tyre stop when in fifth place. He rejoined seventh, behind teammate Alesi. But Alesi was in next with the same complaint, which he passed on to team boss Cesare Fiorio.
Problem with the handling of the car.
Now Senna, still leading but pushed hard by Mansell, was starting to have gear selection troubles. And then Nigel Mansell came into the pits with a puncture. He rejoined, still second, but after all of this he was half a minute behind Senna. But with Senna's gearbox trouble, he started to close fast. Eric Comas retired in smoke and flames with the Ligier Lamborghini. And then, dramatically, Nigel Mansell was spinning like a top. He rejoined, but seconds later, he stopped for good. Here's the spin again. Very graceful in slow motion, but this was no mere driver error. Let's hear from the unlucky Nigel exactly what caused his second successive retirement.
The problem we had, I went into the corner in sixth gear, I changed down to fourth, and it jumped from fourth to first gear. Then it locked the rear wheels, and you saw it made me spin. I recovered the spin, got going again, pulled for gears, and there's no gears. The transmission, the actual gears and the gearbox have gone.
Now it was raining, and Senna was gesturing frantically to the race officials to try to get the race stopped. His gearbox was jammed in sixth, so he was relieved when the checkered flag came out. Ron Dennis, knowing how near Senna was to retiring, was overjoyed.
Can't believe it. Shit, brilliant. We got the suit. Yeah.
Maximum points from two races for Senna, nil so far for Mansell. The capability of the Williams demonstrated by Patrese, Berger, Prost and Piquet picking up points despite problems. Senna finished the race drained mentally and physically and in no little pain.
Yes, it's a great day for me. I think comparing to this day only 88 in Japan when I won my first championship. I've been very near to win the Brazilian Grand Prix many other occasions. We've been always very competitive, but for different reasons, we were never able to do it. And today is a memorable day in my career, in my life, and it's a super day. I'm over the moon.
wasn't an easy race by the sound of it, or by the look of you when you finished the race. It didn't look that easy.
Well, I remember 84, my second race in Formula One with the Ptolemy in South Africa, when I finished in sixth place. I had muscle spasm all over the body, and it was the biggest pain I ever had in my life. Today I had something similar, but only my shoulders and neck. And so it was a tremendous pain, but the last few laps. But the desire to win was so big that I kept going, and it was great.
Probably the greatest of Senna's 28 victories to that stage of his career. San Marino in northern Italy, and Imola the venue for round three of the Formula One World Championship. The teams making their way across Europe from various points. Renault arrived to resume their challenge. What encouragement a win would be. Their partners, Williams, having declared their title ambitions, had 14 races to make an impression. They had a great package, and it still hadn't been enough so far. World champions for McLaren and Williams, Niki Lauda and Keke Rosberg in memory lane. And the Brazilian connection, Emerson Fittipaldi, Ayrton Senna's boyhood idol, with a few words of encouragement.
Well, I'm very pleased, very happy, you know, to see all my friends. I think it's great, and you know, I have a good feeling, and so nice to see people that I work together, race against, and it's a beautiful feeling.
There were new models on parade at Imola, the long-awaited Benetton, admired by their former driver, Alessandro Nannini. Nannini out of racing since that terrible helicopter accident last year that severely injured his right arm. Footwork were hoping that the A11C would earn them points. Michele Alboreto had an unfortunate introduction to his. A testing crash ruined any chance of it being ready for San Marino. So Alex Caffey debuted the new car.
Michele, we've seen you limping around the paddock. You're obviously in pain still.
Maybe because I'm getting old. quite painful at the moment, but I'm happy to be here anyway, even because I must use the old car. But I think every lap that we made with this Porsche engine can improve our performance. So I think I'm here for make my job.
Will you be driving in the race, do you think?
Oh, yes, I would like, but I don't think it's possible to qualify the old car. And unfortunately, we have only one new car, so we try to qualify that one. And Alex is in the better condition, so he's right and he drives the new car.
Showing off their new BT60Y, Brabham, looking for an improvement in fortunes, a team which had the essential elements, but found success elusive. AGS, under new management, introduced Fabrizio Barbazza in place of Stefan Johansson. The Italian, another recruit from Formula 3000. Formula One supremo Bernie Eccleston with the boss of Formula One's most famous team, Cesare Fiorio.
We think we have made quite a big improvement from São Paulo to now, because we have a new front suspension, we have new aerodynamics, and also a good increase in the power of the engine. But we don't know whether this will be enough or not, because Williams and McLaren seem to be very, very fast. And especially Williams, I think this year is doing a fantastic work.
This is Italy. Do you feel as if you're on trial?
Well, of course, here in Italy there is a lot of pressure. There will be, I don't know, 200,000 people around this circuit. And many of these will be for Ferrari, so we hope to do well. Otherwise, we must go out from the back door.
Indeed, great demands on Ferrari to do well on home ground, but Prost in trouble during Friday's practice. And then, things hotting up for Alesi during qualifying in the afternoon. It was Prost that set the Tifosi Pulse racing, with the fastest time of the session. Things looking up for Ferrari, it seemed. Cesare Fiorio certainly thought so, until the Williams Renault of Riccardo Patrese went out and immediately bettered Prost's time on the track where he won the year before. The Williams of Nigel Mansell found Barbazza's AGS a hazard, and he was unable to improve on fourth. It left Ayrton Senna to repeat his Brazilian performance and set the quickest time of the day, from third to first, beating both Patrese and Prost.
To be honest, today we had some problems. I mean, not a performance problem, but it's difficult to know what's going on Saturday and then Sunday morning. We have done a lot of tests here, so we know more or less that the car, even with fuel, is working well, and we should not have a surprise on this this level. In terms of reliability, we must see and work again, because we don't have a big problem, but we have small problems, and that's I would say normal, because we have done a lot of work in the last months, and we must pay for it a little bit. Even if I suppose that this day, I mean today, should be the worst.
Mika Häkkinen of Lotus in his qualifying routine. He'd made a good start to his Grand Prix career, an unflappable, resolute Finn steeling himself for the test ahead. And he needed all his resolve on the Saturday as the rain tippled down. Nobody could improve their time, some didn't bother to go out. Those that did had trouble, like Nigel Mansell. There's one man who revels in wet conditions, Satoru Nakajima. He was fourth quickest in the session, better even than Ayrton Senna.
Half an hour before Sunday's race, the rain returned in a relentless deluge. And as the grid was waved off on the warming-up lap, conditions were impossible. Visibility was in short supply. And here on Ferrari's home soil, the fans could only watch dumbfounded as Alain Prost spun across the grass at Rivazza. Gerhard Berger did the same, but he kept the McLaren going. But Prost was stuck. He'd stalled, and to the dismay of the crowd, he was out before the race had even begun. The crowd didn't know whether to cheer, boo, or weep. So to the green light, and as they scrabbled for grip, a perfect start from Patrese put the Williams in front from Senna and Stefano Modena's Tyrrell, which was ahead of Berger's McLaren. Mansell was down in the traffic and he spun. Z, now carrying all Ferrari's fortunes on his shoulders, elbowed past Modena at Tosa but was going too fast to make the exit. Thud. Dug in again. So both Ferraris out, and now Patrese slowed. Coming into the chicane, Senna went by into the lead, and Ricciardo made for the pits. Listen to his engine spluttering. The Williams mechanics went to work, and Patrese described his problem over the radio. They did get him briefly back into the race, but after a couple of laps, his race was over.
Race was going well. Unfortunately, I had a problem with the engine. That electrical problem, I think. I was driving, I think, very hard to keep Senna behind, but I think I could do it, and also, for me, it was very good to be in front in the wet, because my good feeling for the race was in the dry setup. And I think if I was in front in the wet, I could have even better chance when it was dry.
Now everyone was changing to dry tyres. Berger did so without losing second place. Senna had already been in, and he'd kept the lead. So it was McLaren Honda 1 and 2. Tyrrell Hondas were third and fourth until Nakajima's transmission broke. Followed shortly after by Stefano Modena's. The Italian sitting in the cockpit doesn't want to believe it. JJ Leto took his Dallara past a faltering Roberto Moreno for third place, his best ever position. And Senna reeled off another relaxed victory from his Austrian teammate. As they both drove towards the chequered flag, McLaren's domination was complete. Poor Eric van der Poel lost fifth place when the Lamborghini's engine failed, and two championship points slipped away.
A McLaren 1-2, and pleasure for Keke Rosberg. He manages both Lehto and Hakkinen. A good result all round for Lotus, and the only Ferrari in the top four, the engine in Martini's Minardi. Overall, Senna triumphant.
My main problem was only the engine. The car was not perfect because it was a compromise between wet and dry, but it was good. And my problem was really the engine with the oil pressure. Somehow we had the problem with the oil pressure. I think we had this problem this morning already, and it gave a problem again in the afternoon. And it was more than 30 laps with the oil light flashing. And I dropped the revs immediately on the shifting and also on the straight, start to lift on the straight to not have much revs, and it seemed to work good to at least stabilize the engine. And then I was just trying to control myself with Gerhard, and fortunately for me, unfortunately for him, he also had some problem. And then was possible for me to slow down and still maintain some gap, and then we both were able to finish first and second.
Third place was JJ Lehto's best result ever. An outstanding effort, having started in the back half of the field.
Basically, in the beginning of the race, it was very, very difficult conditions. I mean, starting from the 16th place, there was a lot of smoke and everything, and you couldn't see really nothing. And I was just taking easy, and then when we changed the slicks, it was getting better and better, the car, and I was just going for it.
Another delighted Finn, Mika Hakkinen, who came home fifth.
It was first time for me racing in a wet condition, F1. It was unbelievable. It was, you couldn't see absolutely anything. Even next car in front of you have a red light, you couldn't see that.
Monaco, the jewel in the Formula One crown. The event of the whole motor racing calendar. By the shores of the Mediterranean, showbiz glamour side by side with Formula One intensity. Ron Dennis had moulded his McLaren team into the habit of winning, leaving the rest trailing.
Well, we can't speak for our competition. You can hardly expect a team that exists to win to be concerned about winning too much. We're only getting the results that we work for, and other people are going to have to work harder. We're not going to reduce our effort. We know how difficult it is, and I can assure you it really isn't easy. It's very difficult. We only think we get the result that we work for, and other people have to try harder.
A shock for Martin Brundle, his Brabham disqualified from this most prestigious of races for not weighing in when instructed.
Apparently I failed to stop at the red light and passing the weighbridge. Of course I didn't see the red light, otherwise I would have stopped. We know the situation. Clearly it's my fault for not seeing that light. There were a few mitigating circumstances because they changed the procedure with the flagman, which the officials admitted to. But the rules are the rules, and I'm afraid FISA are the policeman, the judge, the jury and the jailer, and there's no way of appeal. And they threw us out of the race meeting for the weekend.
A huge accident on Saturday morning involving Alex Caffey. His luck ran out when his new footwork collided with the barriers. He too was out of the race. Studying the replay, it's amazing that from such a collision, Caffey could emerge relatively unscathed. Indeed, it's a testament to the improved safety standards in Formula One that he was not seriously injured. The car was a write-off. It was lifted off the track in segments. The whole of the back end totally ripped away from the rest of the chassis. Even the aftermath of the accident was a frightening sight. Meanwhile, a badly shaken Alex Caffey received attention from FISA doctor Professor Sid Watkins.
He's got light concussion from his head banging on the car as he hit the Armco barrier. He said he made a little mistake. You see from the film, it looked like he hit the wall with his rear tire going into the swimming pool, which sent him across the road, collecting the apex of the corner, which rocketed him across the other side of the road into the barrier. There's not much left of the car, but fortunately Alex is okay.
more disappointment for Ferrari. Jean Alesi ninth in qualifying, Alain Prost only two places better off. For team manager Cesare Fiorio, questions needed answering. Gerhard Berger managed sixth fastest in the second McLaren, with a time set in the first qualifying session. Nigel Mansell improved from seventh on the provisional grid to fifth. While Nelson Piquet, not an advocate of racing in Monaco, was fourth in the new Benetton. Third, Riccardo Patrese, out-qualifying his teammate Mansell for the fourth time running. Stefano Modena in the nimble Tyrrell secured a front row grid position for the first time ever. On pole again, Ayrton Senna. He shaved off another 0.2 seconds and still had time to be impressed by Stefano Modena's performance in the Tyrrell.
I think Stefano Modena made a good job today, and if he was able to make such a time, improving so much from the first day, he did a great job. I believe it will be great for us to start in the first row. We know each other, we have respect for each other, and I think we can have a good start and a clean start, and we see then what happens afterwards.
I had a clear lap, I had a precise lap everywhere, and I think I could have done better on a following lap when we changed again the tire and we went out, but I had a person in front of me that stopped, so stopped me the line, so I didn't have a chance to improve my time again. But we are very happy. We improved the car. We are in a good shape for tomorrow, and we're looking forward.
So, V12 Honda versus V10 Honda at the start, but predictably it was Senna who got the jump on Modena, followed by Patrese, Mansell and the rest of the awe-inspiring traffic jam. Down in that traffic jam, Berger ran into the back of Piquet and was left stranded at Saint-Devaut. But he was able to get away again without undesirable help from the marshals. Down to Mirabeau, Piquet was fifth, but look at his left rear wheel. His rear suspension had broken, and he parked in the escape road. Senna rapidly built up so huge a lead that he caught a marshal by surprise. Modena was still second from Patrese and Mansell. And the marshal had a tale to tell his grandchildren in years to come. Another incident which could have been so much worse. Berger's race at the tail of the field ended in the barriers at the swimming pool. And then Modena's engine blew in the tunnel just in front of Patrese. There's the smoke, and there's Patrese bouncing off the barriers. Modena stopped his car at the chicane, and Patrese's car, badly damaged, was out too.
Do anything when you go 260 kilometers an hour. In a corner, if somebody put down oil, you go off. There is no chance.
And just look at the oil washing out of Modena's ruined engine. As for Modena, he was too disappointed to speak. All this left Prost second, Mansell third. But Mansell was desperate to open his 1991 score. And in a perfectly judged charge through the tunnel, he got a run on the Ferrari. He was alongside into the chicane, braking late and hard, and forced his way through. Demoted to third, Prost decided to stop to investigate a loose wheel. And this time the Ferrari team got a wheel nut stuck under the back of the car. When he rejoined, he was fifth behind teammate Alesi and Moreno's Benetton, which Senna lapped on his way to a fourth consecutive victory. The 1991 championship was starting to look pretty well sewn up. But Nigel Mansell scored at last with a splendid second place. The Williams team in the pits were delighted. The transmission had held together. And as Senna and Mansell congratulated each other, perhaps they both knew that the real battle was just beginning.
So Mansell's first points of the year, Alesi ahead of his illustrious teammate Prost, A reward for Moreno's hard work and a first point of the season for Pirro. But Senna with that perfect score, 4 out of 4.
I'm very satisfied with the result, of course. It's a great victory. And I'll say nothing. I had some problems, but I'll say nothing because what it matters is what we achieve in the end. Is the result and is the victory that counts, another 10 points for the championship. But for sure, to race here in Monte Carlo, almost 2 hours race, it's very hard physically because it's bumpy and it hurts a lot, your shoulders, your neck and so on. And if you have also to change gears, it really hurts. I won and I'm happy and that's it.
A quarter of the way into the season and Senna galloping away into the distance, 29 points better off than anyone else and 34 more than Mansell, the equivalent of 3 race wins and a third. But even at Monaco, Mansell was not trouble-free.
I had a number of problems. One was a slow change with the gearbox, but I'm very happy because it got me through to the end of the race. Twice the engine cut and stopped on the circuit and I had to restart it by using the clutch. Then I was catching Alan, which surprised me a little bit with all the problems. And then I don't know who blew up, but there's a lot of oil and everyone was keeping to the right. And I think Alan made a little bit of a mistake going into the tunnel, which enabled me to come alongside coming out. And by the grace of the good Lord, I managed to stop in time for the chicane. It was quite exciting, but it was reasonably safe.
McLaren with a commanding lead in the Constructors' Championship. Ferrari and Williams both expected to challenge, lagging behind. The crumbs for Benetton, Tyrrell and Dallara. Transatlantic for round 5, Montreal and the Circuit Gilles Villeneuve at the beginning of May. 2.75 miles round, Senna had won 2 of the last 3 races here. Resuming a promising career blighted by injury, the British driver Johnny Herbert, given another chance at Lotus in place of Julian Bailey.
It was just after Julian had a few problems, I think financially. It gave me a chance, because I'm very close with Peter, that I could step in his replacement.
Alex Caffey's problems continued too. A road accident ruled him out, and Stefan Johansson was named as replacement at Footwork. Significant changes too at Ferrari. Cesare Fiorio had been held responsible for the team's scrappy performances thus far, so was replaced by Claudio Lombardi, who'd been running the Lancia Rally team, and Piero Ferrari.
My new job is more or less like in the old days, but now I'm overlooking all the activity. The new person, the only new person in the racing department is Engineer Lombardi, which is coming from rally racing from Lancia. And he is responsible on the all activity at home and on the racing track.
Really, this is a technical job, I think, 80% Formula One. So, really, you can have a fantastic organization and so on, but if the car is not fast enough, and very good driver as we have, if the car is not fast enough, there is nothing to do. So I think this is the challenge. First is a technical challenge.
Now, contrary to widely held beliefs, it's not all work and politics in Formula One. This is the mechanics raft race across the Olympic rowing basin. It was eventually won by the Jordan team. A first, if unlikely, win for them in an impressive debut season. Jubilation from the team left on the bank. It's an event with few rules, and that means fair cheating all round. Back to business, and a rare sight of a McLaren in trouble. Senna's engine blew during practice, and oil deposited on the track caused the Williams of Riccardo Patrese to crash. He suffered bruising to his neck and chest, but was pronounced okay to race. Patrese can ill afford a crash of any kind. The spare car at Williams is the sole preserve of Nigel Mansell. a wet track for Friday qualifying, but everyone attempted to set a time. Mansell was the quickest of all, but some 15 seconds slower than he might have expected had the circuit been dry.
It's quite bumpy, but you know, when it's raining, it's a big gamble. So, I mean, we're just happy that we're on pole position today. I hope it snows tomorrow.
A wish not granted. It was all changed by Saturday morning, dry and clear, and for once, Ayrton Senna was eclipsed in qualifying. His good time of 1:20.3 was beaten by both the Williams cars, and Senna had to settle for third place on the grid. Then came Mansell, 1:20.2, averaging over 122 miles an hour, demonstrating that the gearbox problems were surmountable and the Elf fuel provided extra zip. That also, of course, applied to Patrese, and he, with a late flourish, stole pole position Senna style, making it an all-Williams front row.
Well, this is an hard race for everybody, car, drivers, and the track, in effect, also if there is a new asphalt, it is as bumpy as last year. And because of that, we don't have an easy life, I should say, tomorrow for sure.
Well, nothing in Grand Prix racing is easy. 69 laps, an all-Williams front row, and Mansell and Patrese get away wheel-to-wheel, with Mansell taking the corner. This is Alain Prost getting a bit crossed up, and Senna going past him. Down to the hairpin for the first time, it was Mansell, Patrese, Senna, Prost, Berger and Moreno. But on Aguri Suzuki's Lola, a fuel line broke and the whole car went up. McLaren's problems in Canada began with Berger's retirement with misfiring. Meanwhile, Alain Prost's gearbox wasn't right. Listen to him looking for gears. So he was passed by Alesi, and then Nelson Piquet came up into his mirrors, and the Benetton went by as well. Now a rare occurrence, Ayrton Senna slowing. He too was misfiring. And the Alesi-Piquet-Prost battle came past. This is the view Prost had of Piquet disposing of Alesi for third place. And then he follows through himself. In the slipstream, pedal to the metal, and out of the slipstream and past his teammate. But Senna's race was run. The world championship leader was out of the Canadian Grand Prix.
Well, I had the electrical problems early in the race, and I had no information from my dashboard computer and rev counter. I had no revs reading. I was just changing gears by my ear and no information whatsoever. And I called on the radio, I told the team that I thought was an electrical problem and also a battery, probably a battery going flat. But I couldn't do anything, so I continued for about 10 laps. Then the engine completely expired with the lack of energy. I think it was just battery gone or some short circuit.
And Prost's gearbox, troublesome throughout the race, stopped him a lap later. Truly, this was turning into the year of gearbox failures. The other Ferrari of Alesi didn't last much longer. Its engine failed. Both McLaren's out, both Ferraris out, Williams now 1 and 2. In the closing stages, Stefano Modena was charging in the Tyrrell. Patrese was slowing with his own gearbox maladies. But now Nigel Mansell's dominating drive faltered on the final lap, within sight of the flag. With the race in his pocket, Mansell could only coast to a halt with a dead engine as Nelson Piquet inherited a lucky victory for Benetton, ahead of Modena and Patrese. Meanwhile, poor Nigel Mansell could only reflect on the wisdom of the old motor racing cliché, to finish first, first you have to finish.
Nobody more surprised than Nelson Piquet to pick up the points, or more delighted than Stefano Modena to inherit second place, the best result he'd ever achieved. Patrese salvaged some pride for Williams, but Piquet had the victory.
Well, 3 laps to go, it slowed down because Mansell was about 50 seconds in front of me, and Ricciardo was right behind, And I said, that's it, go for second. Then I got the news from the radio that Mansell, it's slowing down. And I just tried to push again the last lap, but when I saw him, I couldn't believe it. It was very, very good, very lucky.
You must feel a bit sorry for Nigel, though.
Well, I don't feel sorry nobody. This thing happened to me already. I think it's motor racing. I think a win who finish in the checkered flag first.
But Nigel Mansell's misfortune did overshadow everything. Just when it seemed the season had turned round for him, frustration again.
Well, they've just brought the car back, and as often happens in motor racing, the thing fired up and all the gears are there. So some electronic problem, probably due to some type of overheating relation.
A Tyrrell in second place for the first time since Monaco over a year before. And that produced an obviously satisfied Stefano Modena.
I think the team deserved this position, but probably was deserved more in Monaco than here. I'm very happy, and I'm happy more for the team.
More celebrations at Jordan. The significance of the result meant that they'd almost certainly be out of pre-qualifying after the midway point of the season.
I was quite emotional, I have to say. You know, it's a great day for everybody. For me personally, I feel very excited about it, but mainly because, you know, the mechanics and the drivers, and they committed to us ever before the car turned a wheel, and that's quite a brave thing to do. And the mechanics that we have, engineers, have all been with me a long time, and we brought them through the Formula. We didn't hire in a lot of people from Formula One. We wanted to do it our way, and I feel very happy and very proud for them because they stuck with it, and this is justification to what they've done over the winter.
Yeah, it's great. You know, for a team which is in pre-qualifying, to be now fifth or sixth team in the championship, because that's what matters to us, it's just great. You know, it's something for everyone has been working a lot for, and it's an achievement. It was our goal, and we have reached it.
Mexico in midsummer, 10,000 feet above sea level, a severe test of stamina for both driver and car. It was here that it emerged that Harvey Postlethwaite, the talented Tyrrell designer, had left the team to join Mercedes, currently in the World Sports Car Championship. A surprise move.
Well, Harvey was a very important and senior member of our team, and his sudden departure obviously will affect us in the short term. But during his period with us, he has built up a very strong technical team, and there is no reason why we should not continue to improve as the season goes on.
Another designer who left in mid-season, the influential John Barnard from Benetton, soon after Piquet had won the Canadian Grand Prix. Senna flew in from Brazil to Mexico, nursing a nasty head injury. It had required 6 stitches, the legacy of a jet ski accident near his beachside home.
Well, I was having some leisure time, some relaxation, and unfortunately I had an accident with one of my jet skis, and I had an impact on the back of my head, and fortunately that caused me some pain and some discomfort, but I had the proper care taken immediately, and I have had no problems, no side effects since the impact, only a cut, which hopefully will not be much discomfort over the weekend.
But suddenly Senna appeared curiously accident prone. At the notorious Peraltada corner in Friday qualifying, he approached over the limit, hit the tyre barrier and overturned. Fortunately, it was not as serious as it might have been. Senna was eventually pulled out unhurt and departed for medical checks, no doubt rueing being over-adventurous. He'd attempted to take the corner in a higher gear than normal. The car hit a bump and was out of control in an instant. It was a worrying moment for everyone at the track.
It's a nasty corner, and what just happened to Ayrton just typifies how dangerous that corner is. I mean, he went very quick, and you thought that he was going slow until he hit the wall, and then you realise what speed he's doing. And I'm very pleased to see that he managed to get out of the car.
The world champion having been seen by the FISA doctor, Professor Sid Watkins, was pronounced fit.
I just lost the car at the quick corner and in the middle of it, and had a big shunt, but I'm fine.
You're fine?
Yes, no problem, no problem.
Also suffering, Riccardo Patrese, from a debilitating stomach bug. But he still managed the quickest time. His 116.6 was better than last year's qualifying effort from Gerhard Berger, and 0.3 seconds faster than his teammate Nigel Mansell. Mansell, meanwhile, was holding off Ayrton Senna for second place on the front row. Initially, at least, round six was auguring well for Williams.
Yeah, I mean, I'm very pleased because it's the second race running that the race car broke down in the pits. Still got a sense of humour. I jumped in the T car and I got very close to my teammates' time, so I'm very, very pleased because the engine was not quite up to the match of the race car, so the team's done a great job again.
Saturday's qualifying session was disrupted by rain, but Riccardo Patrese was still the fastest man on the circuit. Williams were in business.
As the pre-race tension built up, Riccardo Patrese was determined not to be beaten from his second consecutive pole position, but once again Mansell was quicker away, with Senna and Alesi chasing, and Alain Prost close behind. Now watch Alesi on the left going inside Senna, while Piquet goes inside Prost. And this is the view in Berger's mirrors. It was all a bit close for comfort through the complex of corners after the start, and Alain Prost was losing out in the traffic. But behind Mansell, Senna was now wheel to wheel with Alesi, moving wickedly across on him once he was in front. Behind them, Stefano Modena was pushing Berger hard when Berger's engine exploded. Both Berger and Modena were lucky not to go off on the oil that came out of the burst Honda. But others were not so lucky. Pierluigi Martini's Minardi was one that came to grief. And now Ayrton Senna was under pressure from Patrese, recovering from his bad start to take second place. Once past Senna, Patrese began to close on teammate Nigel Mansell. Clearly the Williams Renaults were the equipment to have here. And Alesi's Ferrari got past Senna too. So now the world championship leader was down to fourth. Patrese had his eyes on the lead, and on lap 15 he was alongside down to the first corner. But Mansell wasn't going to make it easy. A tense Frank Williams watched as Patrese stayed alongside through the complex and came out ahead. Now it was Alesi's turn to challenge Mansell. But sometimes if you get by, you're going too quick to stay on the island. With Mansell now worried by overheating, Ayrton Senna was going to challenge him too. But Nigel managed to hold him off. Not for want of trying by Ayrton. Finally, Jean Alesi spun out for good, with clutch failure. And Riccardo Patrese went on to take a magnificent victory here in Mexico. And it certainly made Patrick Head's day.
Well done, you bastard. Good stuff. Good stuff.
For Riccardo and Nigel, it was a sweet moment. The McLarens were well and truly vanquished.
What encouragement for Williams with that 1-2 and Senna almost a minute behind. Andrea De Cesaris with another good finish. More points for Roberto Moreno and a first of the season for Eric Bernard. But the Williams pair provided most of the action.
Well, it was a normal racing. I think Nigel tried to keep his position and I charged very hard. I think it was a quite exciting moment. Probably it was good for the spectators and for the show. I think in that particular moment I felt quicker than Nigel. He probably had some problem, I don't know. My car was running perfectly since the beginning to the end, and I didn't have really any problem to push very hard in the middle of the race, and then to control the latest charge of Nigel. Also, if really I have to say that he was pushing very hard, because at the end I had a big trouble to keep him behind.
After Mexico, the Formula One teams moved back to Europe. Since last season, the venue for the French Grand Prix had changed from Paul Ricard in the south to Magny-Cours by Nevers, nearer Paris. A purpose-built circuit with a spacious paddock with room for the masses of high-tech equipment that a Formula One team needs to survive. On home ground, the FISA president, Jean-Marie Balestre, with footwork boss Jackie Oliver. Oliver had decided that his team would revert to Ford engines rather than the Porsche units they'd run so far in the season without success. Porsche agreed the engine needed further development, and with the team about to slip into pre-qualifying, both parties eventually agreed that testing the engine in the Formula One environment did not suit either of them. It was baking hot on Friday for the first session of qualifying. Ayrton Senna, of course, was the first to really get to grips with the track, setting the mark at 1:16.6. A pensive Nigel Mansell having to be content with second fastest time. Alain Prost, ambitious to show well at Magny-Cours. He was fourth fastest. But ahead of Prost came Jean Alesi, third quickest in the new Ferrari 643. At last, a reason to be cheerful. For Senna's supporters, even more so with him on pole position. That was until Saturday, when Mansell went out and set a 1:14.895. A time that would take some beating. Alesi couldn't do it, 1:15.8, although that was good enough for second. Once Senna was out again, he beat Mansell for pole position. Senna conceded the psychological advantage was important, and his time looked good enough until an inspired Prost suddenly found a little extra, Ferrari's high spot of the season. The ex-world champion fastest at his home Grand Prix in a brand new car.
It's difficult for everybody, for me, because a lot of pressure this track, and to bring a new car like this and having no problems at all during the weekend, it's a big show from the team. I mean, they work very well, and the mechanics were very hard in a few days, and it's quite spectacular not to have any big problems, and reliability and performance was better and better through the weekend, so it's good.
Ferrari's joy was short-lived. Patrese had qualifying tyres left and used them wisely at the end of the session. 1:14.559 was a massive improvement in 24 hours.
Mainly the temperature was a little bit cooler, and I think also the track became a bit quicker, maybe rubber down. So the track became a bit quicker because of that, and especially the temperature, because yesterday was much hotter.
When Olivier Grouillard splattered oil on the racing line in the last minute of qualifying, he did Williams a favour. Following right behind Grouillard was Senna on a flyer. He hit the greasy bit and skated out over the line. Third place was all he could manage on the grid.
A little bit of oil on the circuit that was dropped by a car that was just 1 minute before me on the circuit. And then the track was slippery. During the lap, I lost the car a little bit in a corner because it was slippery. And finishing the lap, it was really slippery here at the chicane, and I just lost the car, putting the power down, but crossed the finish line instead of facing forward 90 degrees, so I had a little bit of fun. But it was no danger because it's very slow, that part of the circuit, and wide, so it was safe.
Another Patrese pole position, another disastrous Patrese start. His electronic gear change selected the wrong gear, and he had to watch as the rest rushed by, led by Prost, at the head of his home Grand Prix. Gachot was the first casualty with the Jordan. And at the end of lap one, it was Prost from Mansell, Senna, Berger and Alesi. This is Piquet's rear view as he passed Benetton teammate Moreno. Once again, Berger was an early casualty. His third consecutive engine failure. And here's Morbidelli trying to pass Piquet. All of which helped Patrese up a couple of places. Up at the front, Prost was still leading the Ferrari Renaissance. But Mansell was gaining ground. As they came up to lap de Cesaris, Mansell seized his chance and pulled away into the lead. But the routine tyre stops were to reverse the position. Prost's lasted 7 seconds. Mansell's lasted 10.5 with a difficult front wheel. And the Frenchman was back in front. Mark Blundell hit the pit wall when lying 11th. But at the front, in the traffic, Mansell was on top of Prost once more. And he muscled his way through to retake the lead. Today, no one was going to deny him. But it was a great debut for the new Ferrari, and this was very much a race to raise Ferrari's hopes. On the very last lap, Jean Alesi in the number 28 Ferrari was pushing Senna hard for third place, and so nearly made it. For Mansell, the checkered flag was waving at last. After the race, Alain Prost was the first to congratulate the Englishman.
Hey, good old man.
Go on the podium.
10 points at last for Nigel Mansell. Two Ferraris in the top four, but no sign of a win for them as yet. Personally for Mansell, a significant moment. His 17th Grand Prix win, an English driver's record.
I'm still recovering. I'm in a little bit of shock. It might sound silly after all these years in Formula One, but to get past 16 for an Englishman is history. And I've made history for myself and my country. Alan had a fantastic start. Unfortunately, I had a good start, which was ironic because the racing line was on the right, but he made a fantastic start and I followed him. And then it was just a question of trying to keep going. Alain was going very quick at the beginning, and then I managed to get past, and then he passed me in the pits again. And then afterwards, it was just a question of just working very hard because the Ferrari was going very well, Alain was going very fast, and he had some traffic problems, and I had some big traffic problems. It just made for an interesting race.
My start was very good, one of the best maybe I've done in my career. I was quite pleased to be the first corner. The car was very good when it was full of fuel. Then it started to be worse and worse, but that's a bit normal. The car is new, and if the race was now, I would change the setup for sure. But I'm quite pleased with the second position anyway.
A week later, across the channel, the British Grand Prix at Silverstone. It had been vastly remodeled. Generally, the drivers approved.
Well, I like before a lot the old Silverstone, but they done a very good job in this one, and the circuit very interesting, and I think it'll be very hard work for the drivers, and I think it'll be a new Silverstone even better than before.
The circuit has changed from a tactic circuit to a hard drive challenge circuit. You've got to drive hard now, and you have very quick corners which you have to be very precise of it.
There was big news pre-race in the pit lane. Tom Walkinshaw, successful owner of TWR, former Le Mans winners and current leaders of the World Sports Car Championship with Jaguar, had acquired a 35% stake in Benetton. The phlegmatic Scot had always said that he'd make the step up to Formula One when the time was right.
I think it gives us an excellent opportunity to get involved in Formula One with a front-running team, and hopefully from that base, which is already good, improve it, that we can actually have one of the top three or four teams in Formula One. I think that their strengths in sales and marketing and our strengths in engineering combined together will really form the basis of a good team for the future.
The British fans, of course, supported only one man, and he gave them an initial treat on Friday, setting fastest time, then avoiding Aguri Suzuki while trying to go even faster. In the pits, VIPs on Saturday, none more important than Prince William being shown around by Jackie and Paul Stewart. Up in the grandstand, Rockstar regulars George Harrison and Mark Knopfler. Down in the paddock, would-be racer Simon Le Bon from Duran Duran. On the track, Alesi was third quickest. Familiar with the old Silverstone, quite happy with the new one. Riccardo Patrese, second quickest time, 122.109. Distinct possibilities, it seemed, for the Williams team. Prost took over from Alesi and assumed third on the grid. Ferrari was suddenly threatening. Mansell could afford to wait for Senna to roll for a last time. Out on the track, Senna's blistering pace brought him 121.618. Good enough for pole position. Frank Williams had seen all this before. Mansell was in no mood to fail, and anything less than pole position would be failure for his loyal fans. The script said it had to be so. A tense moment of waiting later, and it was confirmed. Mansell on pole at Silverstone. For once, qualifying didn't belong to Ayrton Senna, but he knew that the race would be a different matter. For Mansell, his rapport with the crowd crowned a momentous session.
I was fired up because, I mean, you know, Ayrton's an ace qualifier, and, I was surprised he beat my time, and I just had to go out and do my best, and the great thing was I was fairly charged up myself, and I'm really pleasantly surprised how quick we're going.
I think he did a good job. His car is fast, his engine is fast, but he also had surely a very good lap to go under the 121s. So he deserved. There is nothing to say. He did a good job. He's fast. We all know that. He has a good car, good engine. They are better than us at the moment as a package overall, and they got it together. They deserve to be on pole.
On race day, Silverstone becomes the busiest airport in Britain, with helicopters continually arriving and departing. Definitely the best way to travel to avoid the jams. Out on the grid, Nigel Mansell, carrying the hopes of the 100,000 home crowd.
And with those 100,000 British throats cheering him on, Mansell rocketed away at the green light. But Senna was quicker, and it was the McLaren that led down to Copse Corner. And this is how Patrese felt, being nudged off by Gerhard Berger at Copse. He was able to rejoin, but now Mansell was challenging down the hangar straight. And as they came down to Stowe, he took the lead. The cheers of the crowd almost drowned the engines. Patrese, his car too badly damaged to continue, came in to retire. His day's work was done, and Nigel Mansell would be able to get no help from his teammate. In this helicopter replay, watch the third and fourth placed cars as Berger on the inside and Patrese collide. Also onto the grass goes Alesi's Ferrari, which very nearly T-bones the Williams, but presses on. Berger also kept going and was now third from Prost and Alesi, with Alesi lining up to pass his teammate for fourth. And then the young Frenchman set off after the McLaren. And he got him too. Berger was now an early caller at the pits for fresh tyres, dropping to sixth place behind Piquet. And then an untypical spin from Alain Prost sent him in for fresh rubber. Mika Häkkinen's Lotus spun at the same point, and from here on his seat was full of gravel, giving him a very uncomfortable ride. Nelson Piquet was having a private battle with the recovering Gerhard Berger, who came muscling past into fifth place and pulled away. Aguri Suzuki's Lola was retiring, and Jean Alesi was driving into the pits with a broken nose. Two incidents or one? Well, here's what happened as the Japanese driver lying 14th balked the third-placed Ferrari. It was yet another disappointment for the Frenchman. He was none too pleased about the incident, but afterwards he didn't want to say anything about it. And now Andrea De Cesaris was limping away from a badly battered Jordan. He'd lost it in a big way under the bridge. And he was so nearly hit by the Tyrrell of Nakajima as he came back onto the circuit. Alain Prost also had to take avoiding action with the Ferrari, but happily, nobody was hurt. Meanwhile, Frank Williams watched his TV screen impassively. The Silverstone crowds, anything but impassive, cheered him on, and Nigel Mansell went on his victorious way to another magnificent British Grand Prix win. Both hands off the steering wheel in delight, but where was Ayrton Senna? The McLaren had run out of fuel on the last lap, robbing Ayrton of second place. Berger's McLaren ran out too, but after he'd taken the flag, inheriting Senna's second place. On his slowing down lap, Nigel Mansell stopped. A Formula One car isn't designed to be a two-seater, but Ayrton got his lift home. And for his chauffeur, Nigel Mansell, it was 10 championship points and a perfect end to a perfect weekend.
With Senna's problems relegating him to fourth, the momentum was swinging towards Mansell after two successive wins. The euphoria was nothing new, but this time it had been special.
This one was the best. You saw the crowd. I mean, they were fantastic how they responded all weekend. I mean, this is so special. I mean, it won't sink into me yet. Later on in the week it will, but this is just a race unbelievable. It was a hard race, and I blistered my first set of tyres and had to stop for tyres. I was trying to go the whole race. And then the last 10 laps, I was making half the gear changes I usually make because I had big problems with the gearbox. And in fact, the whole last lap, I went around the last two laps in one gear. And so I'm just pleased it wasn't any more laps than it was, because God forbid if we would have stopped again on the last lap.
The championship in the balance. 18 points the difference between Senna and Mansell. Four races ago, it had been 40. Also profiting from Senna's misfortune, his own teammate, Gerhard Berger.
I mean, the first problem for me was on the start, at a good start. I was on the same line with Riccardo Patrese in the first corner. He just turned in. I even couldn't brake enough not to let him go over my front wheel, and it bent my front suspension. Then I had quite a big problem on the car, so that's why I had to stop early for the tires. The rest I had just to take care about the front tire, and I had a big pain in my hand because I lost all my skin. And so I just tried to go as smooth as possible to finish the race. At the end it changed a little bit, the result, and I'm quite happy for that.
At the halfway stage in the season, McLaren were in command. Williams were improving, the rest were struggling. The major disappointment, undoubtedly, Ferrari. Round 9 of the World Championship, Germany at the end of July. Hockenheim, the venue, picturesque, set in the Rhine Valley close to Heidelberg, but a circuit with two long high-speed straights that never should be underestimated. 4.25 miles round, a circuit where power is paramount. It was at Hockenheim that Satoru Nakajima, the popular Japanese driver, announced his intention to retire at the end of the season. He'd first appeared in Formula One with Lotus, then joined Tyrrell. By contrast, another newcomer from Formula 3000, Michael Bartels, was chosen to stand in for Johnny Herbert at Lotus. Herbert had previously been contracted to race in Japan. Into the second half of the season, and out of pre-qualifying, Dallara, Lehto having secured 4 points, Pirro won. Modena, after Larini's seventh in Phoenix, also missed the early Friday morning. No need for an early alarm call either for Jordan. They had 10 points, courtesy of De Cesaris and Gasho. Back into pre-qualifying went Brabham, but that was nothing new for the experienced Martin Brundle.
Well, we have to get up earlier on a Friday morning, of course. Pre-qualifying is a bit of a lottery. Here at Hockenheim, it went very easily for us, and I was easily the fastest. And in fact, because we had no major problems, it gave us more track time, so it worked out quite well for us.
AGS also slipped into pre-qualifying. Bob Batzer failed to make qualifying proper, though his teammate Tarquini did. Footwork also having to pre-qualify. Alex Caffey returned unsuccessfully, but Alboreto won through. Friday practice, Morbidelli's Minardi and the Berger McLaren. Put it to music, it's an Olympic sport. More seriously, in Saturday practice, Eric Comas, the Frenchman, in his debut season with Ligier, was trying too hard and came to grief at the Ost curve, fortunately without injury. But it was an accident that provoked protests at the construction of the chicanes in use on the Hockenheim circuit.
I don't know what happened exactly. I was flat on six just before the second chicane here on Hockenheim. And just before I, about 50 meters before I brake, the wheel moves a lot and the car go on the, just a little on the left. And then I spun and I crash. But I don't know exactly why.
Airlifted to hospital for a precautionary checkup, Eric Comas was soon back at the track side, recounting his tale in the paddock, pronounced fit to race. On the circuit, Gerhard Berger, perennially unlucky it seems, in the McLaren number two. Mauricio Gugelmin, a season which was really below average in the Leighton house. Pierluigi Martinez Minardi in Revolution. Williams, in the form of Nigel Mansell, had claimed provisional pole position in Friday qualifying. On the Saturday, an intense battle for third place between the two top number two drivers, Riccardo Patrese and Gerhard Berger. Patrese ahead first of all, Berger quicker by the end of the session. The number one McLaren of Ayrton Senna, he improved his time in second position, but he was unable to match Mansell. Senna's pit boards showing P2, a rare sight indeed, but it stayed that way. 137.274 was 0.2 seconds slower than his great rival. Mansell, on his last flying lap, held up by Eric Comas. The Frenchman, of course, receiving the customary friendly greeting in these circumstances. The improving form of Mansell and Patrese concerned the McLaren team, and Senna in particular.
We are waiting for new things soon, and we have to give time, but I think for the difference we are looking for to catch the Williams, we need a lot more than we are going to have soon, and we need it fast, of course, because the championship is still open for me, and with the performance that the Williams Renault have got right now, we just cannot compete with them. And if we want to compete in the championship, we need those improvements very soon.
A perfect start for Mansell, who fishtailed to his right to keep a potential Senna challenge out, and still had time to regain the ideal line for the first right-hander. But it was Berger who slotted into second place from Senna, Prost and Alesi. Behind, Blundell and Lorini spun in the traffic. Blundell carried on, but Lorini and his Lamborghini were out for the day. Meanwhile, Mansell was moving away with a huge lead at the first chicane from the McLarens. Patrese was already splitting the Ferraris after another slow start, and he was winding in Prost. Watch them use the curves at the chicanes. Gerhard Berger was the first to stop for tyres, and it was a bad one. An oil fire at the back and a slow front right, and this stop dropped him from second place to 10th. This is Senna lapping Capelli on his way to the pits. And in fact, second man Senna and third man Prost came in at the same time. Both crews worked feverishly, and the two of them carried on their race down the pit lane. Now it was Mansell's turn. It was a good stop. This time for the Williams team, everything went according to plan. When Nigel rejoined, he came out just behind Jean Alesi in the number 28 Ferrari. And Alesi was on the harder Goodyear B compound tyres, trying to go through without a stop. Effortlessly, Nigel got the lead back. There was nothing Alesi could do about it, but still, his tyre strategy had got him ahead of his teammate Alain Prost. And Prost was in the middle of a huge battle for third with Senna and Patrese. It was Patrese round the outside into the chicane. But now the Italian had Ayrton Senna to cope with. And into the stadium, he muscled past him into third place. 13 laps later, a slingshot past Alesi put Patrese second, braking really late for the chicane. And now we had Senna versus Prost for fourth place. Today the Ferrari was faster than the McLaren. But Senna kept the door firmly shut and the frustrated Prost was forced off at the second chicane. Then, trying to rejoin, he stalled the engine. But as Nigel Mansell went on his winning way, the drama wasn't over yet. Senna, in fourth place, felt his car falter. For the second race running, he pulled off. Out of fuel. Wasn't it Ron Dennis who said in motor racing you shouldn't make the same mistake twice? So Nigel Mansell took the checkered flag for the third time on the trot. Another fine Williams 1-2.
Just 8 points separated Senna and Mansell after Hockenheim. There were useful points there too for Gasho and De Cesaris and for Berger and Alesi. But Mansell and Senna was the battle that everybody concentrated on.
It was a tough race for many reasons. One, because the engine is 65% flat out, you have to be very careful with that. And then also the tyres. I think I've listed one of my sets of tyres, and I think Ricardo and I both had the similar problem with a very long brake pedal. But it's quite difficult.
Still obvious animosity between Prost and Senna. It dated back further than this one race. Indeed, to the championship battles between the two in 1989 and 1990.
I can't win the championship, but if I find him again the same way, if he's correct the same way, I push him out, that's for sure, because I can't also accept that the FISA, they put $10,000 fine to Guggenheim or Suzuki and Maniku and Silverstone, and they never do anything for top drivers. And if you have a rule, it must be the same for everybody.
I think everyone knows Prost by now. He is always complaining either by the car or the tires or the team or the mechanics or the fuel. Or
or the other drivers or the circuit. It's always somebody else's blame. It's never his fault. I think I haven't seen television, but it should be on television. It's clearly that he overshoot under braking. He risked a lot there. He could have put himself in an accident and also involved me in that. And fortunately, we didn't touch, but he almost cost me an accident there, and he almost cost him an accident too.
Mid-August, and Formula One made its annual visit to what was once the communist bloc in Eastern Europe. Hungary had hosted a Formula One Grand Prix since 1986, but nobody could remember the Danube as swollen and flooded as this. The river, which divides Buda from Pest, was threatening to submerge both. Nigel Mansell celebrated his birthday in style, excited about his special present.
A horse, and I'm getting that tonight.
Such a popular driver in Hungary, but what did he intend to do with the extra horsepower?
I'll ride to the circuit tomorrow.
He almost did. Not quite Lester Piggott, but close. The latest development at McLaren Honda, the semi-automatic gearbox, along the lines of those already employed at Williams and Ferrari, but not yet ready for use in a race. The black armbands, worn as a mark of respect for the late Sakairo Honda, founder of the company that carries his name. He was 84 when he died, shortly before the Grand Prix in Hungary, a man who was capable of teaching everybody something, according to McLaren boss Ron Dennis.
I learned from him what it's like to be able to keep your motivation until you're 80-odd years old. And fortunately, I'm only 44, so I've got a while to go, but he's an inspiration to everybody in Formula One.
After a lengthy meeting, the rift appeared healed between Prost and Senna.
For the benefit of both of us and everybody, and also of the sport, we should try to find a better way of competing and working in the same environment that we do, for the benefit of everybody, and we agree that. Okay?
FISA had ordered them to sort out their differences, and they'd done so. Prost, though, still carried a one-race suspended ban for his remarks about Senna in Germany. Friday practice, a setback for Riccardo Patrese. The Williams team unsure about their setup for the Hungarian Grand Prix. Mansell, meanwhile, appeared to be finding qualifying rather tiresome, though things were hotting up for Mark Blundell in the Brabham. Senna was quick, under 1 minute 19 for the 2.5 miles, but thought he could go even quicker. Tension down in the pits as Mansell watched the computer timing of Senna and his own teammate Patrese out on the track. Both were faster than him. Another good showing from Patrese.
I'm very happy because I had a few problems during these 2 days, engine problem, brakes problem yesterday. So I didn't have really smooth practice yesterday and today. And to be in first row, I think I can be very pleased. And I have to admit that also if I had fantastic practice yesterday and today, I don't think we could match the Ayrton times because it's too far away from where we are.
After a series of bad starts from good positions, Patrese was taking no chances here, dutifully practicing his routine away from the line in preparation for the race.
If I can, I go into the lead of the first corner, trying to have a good start. That is the best thing I can do, because when I'm in front, I think I have a very good chance to stay in front. We will see.
Patrese's improvement left Mansell on the second row in only third place. And before the end of the session, Senna stole some more of the psychological advantage with a new record qualifying lap, easily beating the previous record by almost 2 seconds.
I'm much more confident in this weekend about our possibilities than I have been now for a long time. That doesn't mean that tomorrow is going to be an easy race. I think tomorrow is going to be a close fight with the Williams and the Ferraris. And all I can do is to try to make the best choices on the fine-tuning for the car for tomorrow's race and have a good start. because here it's important to be ahead on the first corner. I am in the best place on the grid. Hopefully I can make a good enough good start to maintain that position on the first corner.
Well, a good start was exactly what Senna made. And although Patrese was there with him, some really late braking in that first corner kept Senna's lead. With Mansell slotting into third from Prost, Berger and Alesi. Through the fast downhill corners, the whole field got through without incident. And in third place, Nigel Mansell was already hungry to pass his teammate. Alain Prost was an early retirement from fourth place with engine trouble. Another unhappy day for him. And while Ayrton Senna kept his lead, Mansell was now pushing Riccardo Patrese hard. And on the start-finish straight, Riccardo waved his teammate through to second place. So Mansell was where he wanted to be to attack Ayrton Senna. Most went without tyre stops on this smooth surface, but Ivan Capelli needed fresh rubber on his way to sixth place. As for Senna, he'd used a mix of soft and very soft tyre compounds, and he'd made them last to break Mansell's run of wins and score his first victory since Monaco. He'd revived his championship lead, and he'd put in a perfectly judged day's work. As he'd said, winning the race to the first corner had been all important.
So it was Senna first, Mansell second. Capelli and Alesi taking the minor placings, McLaren and Williams splitting the rest between them. Senna claimed 10 points for the first time in six races.
It's satisfying to win this weekend, to be on pole and lead the race and to win, of course. But I think for the championship is a totally open situation. We have a very tough championship between now and the end. I think it's going to be really difficult for us to maintain the leadership in the championship. I think Nigel and Ricardo are driving hard, driving well. They are also having a good package available to them. And they are tough to compete. We have to improve if we want really to compete with them in all kinds of circuits. But we'll try our best and see. It's going to be an exciting championship.
Prophetic words by the champion, but further down, Ivan Capelli and Leighton House picked up a much-needed point for the first time in over a year.
Yes, after 1 year not finishing a race and the first that is finished is scoring also 1 point, I think that is, and also in the probably the hardest race of the year, because today was very, very hot and very, very tough, the race between all the drivers, I think this is a very good move.
Ron Dennis, in the wrong place at the wrong time, became a target on the podium. On the track, McLaren was still the team to beat.
Swinging things round, you know, from uncompetitive to competitive is a real challenge. I mean, it's hard enough to stay there when you get there, but it's very difficult when you fall behind, especially mid-season, to sort of pull your socks up and get with the programme. But as I said, I hope that our plan, our strategy is going to work. I hope that we're going to be strong in the last four races. And of course, I know there's a lot of people are rooting for Nigel to become world champion, and I understand that. But of course, our job is to win all the races and win the world championship. We're a British team, and as much as it may disappoint Ansel, it will most definitely please my mum.
It was Belgium for round 11 in the Ardennes Forest, the famous circuit of Spa-Francorchamps. Adored by most drivers for its variety, 4.3 miles in all, Senna had won four of the last seven Grand Prix here. McLaren and Honda had developed the variable air inlet trumpet on the V12. Depending on the engine revs, the trumpets went up or down to order. The idea was to give the engine more power at lower revs, better efficiency all round. It wasn't a novel idea. Ferrari had tried it before, and Williams were keeping an eye on developments.
Now, we have obviously got fixed trumpets, We don't know whether it's the right or wrong way to go, but what I'm saying is that they have moved the stakes a lot higher, and it's going to be tough for us this weekend too.
One man absent from his home Grand Prix at Spa, Bertrand Gachot, jailed for assault using CS gas in an incident with a London cab driver. A movement appealed for his release from the six-month sentence being served in Britain. The jail term gave Michael Schumacher the opportunity to join Jordan, the 22-year-old German making his debut in Formula One, having learned his trade at the top level with the Mercedes sports car team. The Jordan drive was a great opportunity for him, and he proved his ability with eighth place in the first session of qualifying. A great boost for the team and himself.
Yeah, sure, I'm really happy. But anyway, I have to say, with this car, you can do this qualifying time. You know, the car feels really good, and it makes a lot of fun to drive. And also for the time, I'm really happy, yeah.
Senna claimed provisional pole position, timed at under 1 minute 50. But on the Saturday, Prost went quicker, the Ferrari 643 hurtling round at an average speed of over 140 miles an hour. But just as Alain Prost's lap ended, Senna found a gap in the traffic to go faster still, and he beat Prost's time by a whole second. Mansell then took his chance to steal second place on the grid, temporarily at least. The Ferrari of Jean Alesi was quicker than anyone else up to half distance round the track. Then he was delayed by traffic heading towards the line and could manage no better than sixth. Gerhard Berger played little part in the proceedings with a blown engine, no time set at all in Saturday qualifying. He remained fifth overall. Riccardo Patrese again bumped his teammate Mansell off the front row, a time second only to Senna's. Patrese frequently set better qualifying times than Mansell throughout the season. It left his teammate down on his knees, not praying for divine assistance, just a routine inspection it seemed, but he was concerned at his car's performance.
Yeah, it's going to be tough. I mean, we've won from fourth on the grid before. This circuit's a little bit easier for overtaking, but I'd have liked to have stayed in second if I could, and I think I paid the penalty of going out too early in the session, but there's possibly a threat of a little bit of rain, and I think the track probably got a little bit grippier at the end.
At Spa, it rapidly became apparent that once again, Senna would be the man to beat.
For sure, we tried to beat him. I think here there is more chance than the last Grand Prix in Hungary, for sure, but we have to see our potential against their potential. That is something that we have to check only in the race, we will see.
Problems lay ahead for Patrese. In a routine check, the car's reverse gear couldn't be found. As a result, his brilliant Saturday time was disallowed, and he was dropped from second to 17th on the grid.
Spa starts are always fraught, with the hairpin immediately after the grid. Senna and Prost got away wheel to wheel, but somehow they all got round. And down the hill, it was Senna, Prost, Mansell, Berger and Piquet as they rushed down to Eau Rouge, and Alesi was behind Schumacher. But the Jordan faltered going up the hill. Up to the complex at the top of the hill, Senna and Prost were still at the head of the queue. And watch Nelson Piquet make up a place on Berger. But Schumacher's first Grand Prix was over. Disappointment for Eddie Jordan.
He just radioed in. I think we have a problem with something to do with the engine, and I think it's in the clutch department. We're not exactly sure. It's too early to say until he comes back.
And Alain Prost's race was over on lap three. The Ferrari was on fire. So Prost's sickening record with Maranello continued. But Mansell wanted revenge for Hungary. At the bus stop, he was on Senna's tail. And as he lined up to pass, Senna was coming in for tyres. For a change, this was a slow McLaren stop. It dropped Senna to fifth. while Mansell's a lap later went well. He rejoined third. And he lost no time passing Berger for second. Nelson Piquet, briefly the leader, came in for his stop. So did Berger. But Mansell's comfortable lead lasted only four more laps before the Williams-Renault spluttered to a halt, its race run.
Hello. I hate to say something similar to Canada, but it's obviously an electrical problem. I can't say any more. As to the championship, guys, I can't say anything. Got to see who wins the race. If Ayrton wins the race here, you know the answer. Thank you, everybody. Yes, I am disappointed.
So, Jean Alesi's Ferrari had the lead, with Senna a close second. Patrese was carving through from his ninth row start, taking Piquet for third and closing on Senna. But then sliding off. But Alesi's run ended in a smoky engine failure, another bitter Ferrari disappointment. So Senna was in front, with De Cesaris forcing the Jordan past Piquet for second place. Piquet's tyres were fading. Berger's McLaren would soon be approaching. Patrese too. Here's Berger's McLaren coming past to take fourth place behind Patrese. Then De Cesaris' magnificent charge ended in engine failure. The Jordan team couldn't believe it. This had nearly been the podium finish that Eddie had longed for in his first Formula One season. Then Patrese, briefly second, was also in trouble, smoking. So Berger came through to second. Piquet's Benetton got up to third, and this is Moreno's Benetton, passing Patrese for fourth. So it was another McLaren 1-2, but a very lucky one for Ayrton Senna. Just as in Brazil, his gearbox was almost completely finished.
Senna's fourth consecutive victory at Spa. The first points for Brabham via Mark Blundell. Three Brazilians in the top four, but no doubt about the star of the show after that McLaren 1-2.
10 points, very important today, particularly with Mas and Patrese almost not scoring. So this is a major step forward in the championship, but still the Williams is a faster car and under normal circumstances they are ahead of us. So we went through one more race, we got a fantastic result and we have a little more time until the next one to go forward again in our car combination. We need further improvements in the aerodynamics. We have some things coming up for Monza and we need a more stable engine. Our engine goes up and down, lose power, comes back, and we need to improve the whole package to compete in equal terms with the Williams. But in the meantime, I have 22 points lead with 5 races remaining. Who knows? We will keep trying and we'll wait and see.
Italy in September and Monza. Steeped in motor racing history, the name redolent of Grand Prix. The Tifosi out in force, Ferrari fanatics, every one of them. Their season had been disappointing so far, but they retained their enthusiasm and their high regard for the English lion, Nigel Mansell. On the social scene, a party to celebrate Nelson Piquet's 200th Grand Prix. Gathered at the Benetton motorhome, the press and media, of course, plus colleagues and teammates. Former team manager Frank Williams, Riccardo Patrese, Nigel Mansell, Jean Alesi, and even Alan Prost.
I'm still impressed by somebody having 200 Grand Prix, especially him. He's so relaxed, but I'm sure he can go to 300 anyway. I don't know if I can reach myself 200, but the way is enjoying life and racing, that's why he can reach even, let's say, 250 for sure, without any problem. Still very competitive, and I think that is his advantage, you know, to be relaxed and to enjoy enjoy life. It's not like me.
And a new teammate for Nelson, Michael Schumacher, left Jordan after only one race and replaced Moreno at Benetton. Moreno eventually securing the spare Jordan drive after much behind-the-scenes manoeuvring.
We have Schumacher on a contract until the end of 1995 to our team, with the sole exception of Mercedes-Benz factory ever did come from Grand Prix racing, then they have the right to reacquire his contract.
I'm convinced, and my lawyers have advised me, that we have two signed legal agreements with Michael Schumacher. That has yet to be gone through in the courts, of course. Of course, Schumacher and his advisors will have the same opportunity, to prove that they have a valid contract.
There were some points where Eddie and me can't agree, or I can't agree with Eddie, let me say like this, and I can't accept this. You know, I wouldn't sign a contract which is not good for me. And I got a contract from Benetton which was good for me, and then I did this.
The ethics and how we go about honoring people's contracts. I mean, we either have to get drivers to sign contracts or we just leave it free for all. I'm easy either way, but I think we do have to have some very firm situations.
Initially, Roberto Moreno seemed as stunned as anyone at the dramatic speed of events. He'd been up most of the night trying to find a drive somewhere in Formula One and eventually settled in the Jordan seat on a race-by-race basis. Piquet, ready to celebrate his 200 in style, was initially the quickest in qualifying. But then Michael Schumacher stole the show from his illustrious teammate. Piquet, perturbed by that, hit trouble. And after his slide off the track, the car needed serious attention. Roberto Moreno in the Jordan, determined to prove a point. He managed to go quicker than Nelson Piquet, but still couldn't beat Michael Schumacher, no matter how hard he tried. Mansell out trying for a quick lap, but balked first by the Modena of Eric van der Poel, and then later by the number two McLaren of Gerhard Berger. Even so, Mansell ended up second on the grid. The only problem, it was Senna ahead of him, the champion claiming pole position with his time set in the very first session. It left Mansell only a tenth of a second adrift, but once again he was left to muse over events.
I mean, I had just two horrible laps from the point of view of traffic. I think I passed six cars on my qualifying lap then and still did a 21, one or two, I don't know what it was. A tenth off, I felt sure it would have been quicker than that if we had a clear lap.
Meanwhile, down the pit lane at McLaren Honda, a rare chance to savour the moment.
But no chance to savour anything now. It's an important race for Senna, an important race for Mansell. And once again, Senna's start was superb, with Mansell, Berger and Patrese leading the two Ferraris to the first chicane. And this is Schumacher's view in seventh place. And already this race is the longest in his brief Formula One career. Already Jean Alesi was going for Patrese's fourth place. At the chicane he got it, but he was braking too late. And he rejoined just in front of teammate Prost. But the car was damaged on the curbs and he was in the pits at the end of the lap. Meanwhile, Piquet was leading the second group, and Roberto Moreno departed from his first Jordan race and into the barriers. The culprit was a brake balance problem. He was out. At the front, a quartet had broken away, with Patrese attacking Berger for third place, watched from behind by Prost. And now Patrese set about his teammate Mansell. Mansell let him go. It was all part of their team tactics to wear down Senna. A few laps later, Patrese had the pressure hard on Senna, and in a perfect outbreaking manoeuvre at Ascari, he went ahead. But his moment of glory was destined to be a short one. A lap later, on the same corner, a gearbox problem did this to him. he restarted third. But, as the replay shows, he got neutral instead of third gear as he braked for the chicane. Moments later, he'd stopped for good.
Gearbox trouble, I had an hesitation changing down while I was going to the Ascari chicane. And because of that I spun, because the gearbox was not quick enough to change down gears. I spun, I went away from that moment, did half a lap, and the gearbox exploded. So no more gears.
But Senna was still being pushed hard by Mansell, who was just waiting for his moment. And he did it at Ascari on lap 34. Just like Patrese, but no spin this time. Senna decided that now it was time for a tyre stop. It was a good one, less than 6 seconds. And though it dropped him to fifth place, his fresh rubber helped him past Schumacher for fourth. Then past his teammate Berger for third. And finally Alain Prost for second. But for Nigel Mansell, this was perhaps the sweetest victory of the year. Ayrton Senna and McLaren Honda beaten fair and square in a straight fight. And that championship was still just alive with 4 races to go.
A great boost for Mansell as he entered the last quarter of the season. Piquet finishing behind his new Benetton teammate, points for Prost and Berger. But a vital win for Mansell. Afterwards, he knew he'd been in a race.
I think it was a fabulous race to watch. It was a fabulous race to be in. It was a great fight at the beginning between Ayrton, myself and Ricciardo. I wasn't sure whether Ricciardo was my teammate at one time or not, because he was pushing me very hard when I was right behind Ayrton. Then I decided to let Ricciardo go, because I wanted him to duck and dive with Ayrton to use his tyres up. So I dropped back then just to conserve my tyres in my own airflow, which worked real good. And then I woke up a little bit when Ricciardo got past. I thought, okay, fine, I better go for it now. And then Ricciardo immediately obviously had a gearbox problem, which made him spin. And then it was between Ayrton and myself again. And then I think Ayrton ran into a little bit of a tyre problem, and I managed to squeeze by just before he went into the pits. And then it was a very hard race at the end, because I'd blistered, I think, all my tyres by this time.
A win and 10 points for Nigel Mansell. 18 points now the difference between him and Senna at the top of the championship. Senna picking up those important 6 points for second place.
Sure, better second than nothing. I think it was a tough race, and I was not as quick as the two Williams, and I was struggling. I was struggling with them. They were pushing me. They were pushing me at the beginning, and it was difficult. But then Ricardo got by, managed to get by. Then he had a problem. And Nigel was right there, and he managed to get by the same place again. And from there on, I couldn't follow Nigel. I knew I had some tire problem anyway, so I decided to stop. And it paid off, because otherwise I would have fall back a lot, and I wouldn't even have finished second. So it was a second place, very good.
In the Constructors' Championship, it seemed that McLaren and Williams were destined to dispute the title right to the bitter end. No chance of intervention from the rest, with Ferrari in particular smarting about that. Round 12, Portugal, a fairly recent but very popular addition to the Grand Prix calendar. The initial Formula One race at Estoril in 1983 decided the championship then, and it would surely play an important role 8 years later. Nigel Mansell in relaxed mood with his wife, Roseanne. In Friday qualifying, it was Gerhard Berger in prime form, a stunningly quick time that only Ayrton Senna could approach. On the Saturday, Ricardo Patrese, having claimed third position on the grid from Nigel Mansell, found no response from his car soon after finishing his flying lap. lip readers might like to report the comments to Mr. F. Williams of Didcot. Nigel Mansell stole second behind Gerhard Berger with an expert display on a track he enjoys. But Ayrton Senna goes well here too, and he made it an all McLaren front row. With McLaren 1 and 2, Riccardo Patrese had different ideas. In the closing moments, in a car set up for Nigel Mansell, he rocketed round a smidgen over 1 minute 13 seconds, and that was good enough to claim pole position. So Patrese and Berger on the front row, with the championship contenders immediately behind.
But I mean, for you guys, it couldn't have worked out better. I mean, shit. I mean, geez. For you guys, you got the best grid possible, you know? I mean, for me, it's the worst grid possible.
Sunday morning at Estoril, and Ferrari in trouble again. An oversight by their mechanics resulted in Prost beating a hasty exit from a car that took warm-up too literally, and so forcing him to use the spare car in the race.
There he is in the spare Ferrari waiting for the green light, and this time Patrese's start was perfect. Nigel Mansell chopped in front of Senna. Senna went right, but Mansell went round him at the first corner, and then he went inside Berger to be second. Alesi tried to do the same to Senna, but it didn't work. Prost was once more content to follow the excitement at this stage. Mansell followed Patrese until lap 18, and then went smoothly ahead. Senna at this stage was down in fourth place. It all looked to be in the bag. Here's Ayrton Senna's tyre stop. A record 5 seconds stationary. Off he goes, a perfect stop. But here comes Nigel Mansell. And this was the stop that virtually spelt the end of his championship hopes. Watch the right rear wheel. He stops at the spot. All four wheels are off. The new ones are on. And in less than 8 seconds, he's away, but the right rear flies off, scattering other mechanics. And the three-wheeled Williams stops in the pit lane. Ansell is stranded. He can do absolutely nothing. In slow motion, one of the mechanics on the right rear raises his arm, but his fellow hasn't tightened the nut, and the car starts to leave. Now in the pit lane, another wheel is manhandled on. All sorts of regulations are being broken. The car is lifted bodily. They manage to get the wheel on, but the seconds are ticking away, and Mansell is almost weeping with frustration. Still, it's not finished. Other cars go by, and finally the job is done. Mansell storms away, leaving two black rubber lines down the pit lane. He's now in 17th place. Berger, second, retires in the pits. Alain Prost, third, has another engine failure. And Jean Alesi, now third, is under pressure from Martini and Capelli. This was when they came up to lap Martin Brundle. Watch for Alesi's hand signals before he goes by. And he was able to take Martini with him. Then, inevitably, the black flag for Mansell. In 16 laps, he'd gone from 17th to 6th. An incredible drive. But that pit stop had broken all the rules. And an inconsolable Mansell had nothing to say. In the closing stages, Piquet, a lap down in the Benetton, followed the cruising Patrese home. But poor Capelli lost fifth place when he clouted the barrier in the Leighton Huss. So Piquet and Schumacher in the Benettons moved up to fifth and sixth places. So a Williams win, richly deserved by Patrese, but for all Nigel Mansell's fans, it was the wrong Williams after yet another cruel wrench of fate for the Englishman.
Williams managing to salvage something from the race and so keeping their constructors' title hopes alive. Patrese, though, was certainly conscious that attention would be centred on Mansell's misfortune rather than his win.
But I have to say that I deserve this race because it's all year that I'm trying very hard and probably I could still own the championship fight if I didn't have some bad luck. So at least before the end of the season, I think that I really wanted a victory. I try all my best since yesterday when I got the pole. So I think that, okay, a bit disappointing for Nigel, but very happy for me.
Senna celebrated with an element of relief, while Mansell was down but not out yet. 24 points the difference, three races left. The first at the brand new circuit Catalunya near Barcelona, one of the sporting capitals of the world, the Olympic host in 1992. Almost 3 miles round, the new venue for the Spanish Grand Prix. Gabriele Tarquini decided to move camp from AGS to Fondmetal.
But I changed the team because AGS have the problem to finish the season, and I take the decision to change the team because the Fondmetal was happy to take me, and I finished the season now.
And Olivier Gruyère replaced Tarquini at AGS. Alessandro Zanardi, another Formula 3000 find, stepped into Jordan's number 32 at the expense of Roberto Moreno, the fourth driver of the car this year, a great chance for the 24-year-old Italian.
It's very difficult because everything is new for me here at Barcelona, the track, the car. I never tested the Jordan car before, but, you know, it's very difficult, but I think I have more chance in my Formula 3000 championship on the last race.
Any football manager looking for strikers for the next World Cup might take a look at Nigel Mansell. Well, he should be living in the States by then. Two goals in this friendly involving drivers and media raised an eyebrow or two. But whether he will play football again is another matter. An ankle injury actually cast doubt on his participation in the forthcoming Grand Prix. Luckily, it was his left ankle, and there's no clutch pedal on the Williams.
No, I'm not a good footballer. I just like running around. If you run quick enough, it looks like you're working, but I'm not really.
But there was no doubt at all about the pain he was in from the injured ankle. Quite what his team manager, Frank Williams, had to say about his escapade has gone unrecorded. And so on to qualifying. Ayrton Senna, knowing that he only had to finish ahead of Nigel Mansell in the race to claim his third world title, set a time that was good enough for third place on the grid. Nigel Mansell, still resting that injured left leg, took second on the grid for a race that he had to win to preserve his title chances. And it was Gerhard Berger, rediscovering some excellent qualifying form towards the end of the season, who scurried through the heat haze on the start and finish line to claim the pole. On Sunday morning, rain produced a damp circuit, the extra joker in the pack for a crucial race.
At the start, the rain had stopped, but it was still wet, and the two McLarens moved smoothly ahead at the green light, with Mansell and Schumacher next. Into the first corner, Senna tried to pass his teammate and then thought better of it. Mansell, meanwhile, was all over Senna. It was tremendously slippery, and it was quite a miracle that all the field got through the first corners intact. Schumacher was watching all this from fourth place, and then he decided to dive inside Nigel Mansell for third. While there was excitement at the front, Thierry Boutsen was already off further down on the greasy surface after a tangle with Eric Bernard. And Jean Alesi was attacking Mansell. Schumacher went for Senna. You can see how slippery it is. And then he was himself threatened by Mansell. Berger was getting away at this point, as Mansell disposed of Schumacher again, round the outside, and went after Senna. It was great motor racing on the slippery surface. Meanwhile, Alain Prost, who'd wanted to start on slicks but had been prevented by his team, came in early as a gamble that the track would dry out. He stormed back into the race, now down in 19th place. Mansell wound in Senna and got alongside for second place. Two determined men with the championship uppermost in their minds. Watch how close they get. A real battle of nerves. Mansell has won the corner, but Senna fights back. Lieder Berger came in for slicks, for the track was now almost dry. But removing tape from his brake ducts lost more time before he rejoined in fifth place. And then Mansell and Senna, first and second, came in on the same lap. The Williams team, with the memory of Portugal uppermost in their minds, were slower than the McLaren boys. Senna was out first, and he'd regained the lead in the pit lane. Out went Mansell. The McLaren strategy was to use Berger as the hare. Watch Senna wave him by. Come on, Gerhard. And so Berger, perhaps a little unwillingly, goes into the lead. Schumacher, who'd stopped early, was fourth behind Mansell. And as Nigel closed on Senna on the still damp track, there was a brief further shower of rain. And now we saw something unusual. Ayrton Senna, out of control, backwards off the circuit. Mansell has squeezed through, Schumacher too. Senna rejoins in seventh place. Mansell was on superb form again. Berger was still leading, but watch how Mansell just asserts himself up the inside of a right-hander. And Berger only just stays in control. Now Schumacher was after Berger. But this squirt up alongside the McLaren ends in a spin. Nothing daunted, the German rejoined in sixth place after a bit of autocrossing. Next, Alesi was brought in by the organisers and held at the top of the pit lane for 10 seconds, a punishment for weaving at the start. It dropped him from fifth place to ninth. And it put real fire back into his driving for the rest of the race. Just look at the speed he went down the pit lane. And then Berger was in to post his seventh retirement of the season with engine trouble. And Alesi, still fuming from his penalty, was catching Senna for fourth place, slicing by decisively. Martini did the last lap on three wheels. Morbidelli and Zanardi had gone off together, just as Morbidelli's teammate Martini came innocently along. And look what happened next. Not quite what you normally mean by team tactics. So a fine win for Mansell, a poor fifth for Senna. And mathematically at least, the championship wasn't quite over yet.
The result for Mansell. Schumacher scored another point. The Ferraris were happier at Barcelona than usual. But the talking points, the brilliant Williams recovery after Estoril, and Mansell's superb drive.
It wasn't so nice from where I was. No, it was reasonably clean, and
But I think everybody saw that it was a very, very big fight, and Ayrton was giving no quarter, and Gerhard was giving no quarter, and there wasn't much room on a number of occasions. But a great race for everybody, and a good race for me. I'm very happy.
There was much to risk imposed on those two overtake maneuvers, and I don't really understand why Mansell is doing what he's doing. But I was able to avoid any contact when he was trying to overtake me, and just as I did in Portugal. And I will do my best in the last two races as long as I can to avoid that. But of course, I am also fighting for the championship, and I have to get a little bit tougher instead of opening the road every time that somebody comes playing everything over me. So we wait and see.
Heading for Japan, Mansell knew he had to win the last two races to keep his title hopes alive. Suzuka in the rain, and a welcome return to the Grand Prix scene for Bertrand Gachot. Out of jail, but not as yet into a car.
Well, my job is to drive Formula Ones. I think before what happened, we were driving good. I just had done the lap record in Hungary, and everything was going well. I was 11th in the World Championship. So I believe it was very unfair to put me in jail, and certainly it was unjustified. So I hope that I can get to my place and better it.
Despite the rain before the first day of qualifying, Nigel Mansell remained in good humour.
And then, I mean, welcome to sunny Japan. I mean, it's great, isn't it? Come here for your suntan. Jeepers. Nice, easy weekend. Plenty of relaxation. No football. No boxing. I'm not going to be a triathlon this weekend. I'm just going to drive cars nice and quiet.
In at Leighton House, another recruit from the World Sports Car Championship, the Mercedes driver Karl Wendlinger from Austria. He replaced Ivan Capelli, who played team manager for the weekend. The new president of the sports governing body, FISA, arrived at Suzuka. Max Mosley, who'd been voted instead of Jean-Marie Balestre, here chatting with Ayrton Senna and Ron Dennis. Afterwards, he outlined FISA's aims.
Well, I think the main thing is to make sure this is a top-level professional sport. We're talking about Formula One. And the main function of FISA is to do everything from its side to match that level of professionalism. I think we've got to make sure that the entire FISA operation, which is really a refereeing operation, is at the same high professional standard that the teams operate to. Having said that, that's Formula One. The main work, for me at least, and the FISA generally, is outside Formula One and in the lesser formulae and with the countries where there is relatively little motorsport. Our job is to try and build motorsport up in those countries all over the world.
Upsets in practice at Suzuka. Pierluigi Martini in the Minardi Ferrari. His accident delayed the session. No sooner was it underway again than Gabriele Tarquini made a mess of his new Fond Metal. More seriously, Eric Bernard in the LaRousse, still in the cockpit of his crashed car. There's some indication of the impact from the replay here. Amazing that the driver didn't suffer major injuries. Bernard with a broken leg that will keep him out of Formula One until next year. Helicoptered to hospital, LaRousse ran just one car at Suzuka. Jean Alesi out in the Ferrari, finding Suzuka troublesome, the car out of shape in more ways than one. 1991 just wasn't Alesi's or Ferrari's year. Michael Schumacher, another young charger, walking back after his skirmish in the Benetton. Made a great impression in the first few races, Schumacher, but he demonstrated that nobody's infallible in this game. Nigel Mansell, all he had to do was win. Ayrton Senna, all he had to do was finish ahead of Mansell. It was Mansell, third on the grid eventually, 300ths of a second slower than Ayrton Senna. Senna content with a front row position, especially as Mansell was behind him. He had a chance to control the race. He could send the pole position man Gerhard Berger away as the hare at the start. Mansell was determined. after last year, no quarter to be given at the first corner.
I mean, I had the perfect line of sight of what happened last year between Ayrton and Alan at the first corner, and as you know, I drove for Ferrari then. And I'm not going to certainly give him the opportunity to do the same sort of thing for me.
If I finish second place tomorrow, the championship will be over. If Mansell does not win, then it's almost certain that the championship will be over as well. So it's an open situation, but it's been slowly coming to our way, the championship, particularly the second half of the season. Bit by bit, step by step, and let's hope that tomorrow is the last bit that we are missing for it.
Race day fortunately dawned fine. All around Suzuka, the race fans displayed their respective loyalties. Many of them backed Nigel Mansell. But Ayrton Senna was not without his supporters.
With two McLarens on the front row, Mansell was down in third spot on the grid. And at the start, the team tactics between Senna and Berger became clear. Berger led down to the first corner. Two McLarens, two Williamses, two Ferraris. And no repeat of last year's collision. But poor Jean Alesi's race didn't last the first lap. Another blown Ferrari engine. More disappointment for Maranello. So while Berger led, Senna concentrated on keeping Mansell down in third place. This four-car shunt started with a spin by De Cesaris, and it also took out Lehto, Pirro and Wendlinger. And now Mansell was going for it, getting very close to Senna. He was doing all he could to keep the pressure on. Down the start-finish straight they came, and leaving his braking very late for turn one on lap 10, Mansell ran wide. It was all over. He kept his engine running, but the car was bogged down, and you could read the resignation in his shoulders as he climbed out. His championship battle was finished, and in the Williams pit, Patrick Head gave Frank the news. And here, in slow motion, is how it looked from Nigel's cockpit. It was another bumpy ride into oblivion, but Nigel was magnanimous in defeat.
Basically, I went in deep. I was starting to feel my way with it, and I wasn't in real hurry. But in the warm-up this morning, I had a slight problem with the brake pedal. And I think it was a combination of just going into my deep braking point. And when I hit the pedal, I'm afraid the pedal was a little soft. And I didn't retard, I didn't slow down, which you could probably see on television. The car didn't slow down. And then I ran out of road then, it's as simple as that. I mean, we've given it a great go. The team's done a fabulous job. I'd like to congratulate Ayrton now on his third world championship. Yeah, there's always next year, and we'll go to Australia and enjoy Australia.
All that was left now was for McLaren on Honda's home soil to stage a crushing 1-2. Berger waved the re-crowned champion into the lead. But behind this demonstration, there was still some motor racing going on. There was a good battle for fifth between Martini, Schumacher and Brundle. But that three-car battle became a two-car fight, promoting Brundle to sixth place, when the Benetton slowed to a halt. It had a blown engine. Then Martini stopped with electrical trouble. So, to the delight of Yamaha, Martin Brundle was up to fifth place. It was a reminder that Honda aren't the only Japanese Grand Prix engine manufacturer. the final lap. And after a word from McLaren boss Ron Dennis over the radio, Senna pulled aside to let teammate Gerhard Berger take the race. Senna, of course, knowing that the championship title was already his since Mansell's retirement. So joy for Berger, not his first Japanese Grand Prix victory, but his first ever win for McLaren. And he says thank you to Senna. And from Ron Dennis come congratulations by radio to Ayrton Senna on his third World Championship title.
The McLaren 1-2 sealed the driver's title for Ayrton Senna. Patrese with third ensured that the Constructors' Championship lived on until Adelaide. Brundle earned points, so ensuring that Brabham wouldn't have to pre-qualify next year. In Parc Fermé, Mansell sportingly congratulated the new champion. Once again, the title had been decided in Japan. But in contrast to the two previous years, it seemed that motor racing had been the overall winner.
It's been exciting one for me. I won here in 88, was memorable too. 89, I was rubbed badly by the system, and that I will never forget. But 1990, it went the other way. It was a sad championship in 1990, but it was a result of the 89 championship and a result of the politics that we had in 1990 and 89. Then 91, fortunately, we were able to have a clean championship without politicians, without people playing any game. It was a technical and a sportive championship that we had this year. And I hope it will be an example, not only for myself, but for everyone that's competing in Formula One now and in the coming future.
So it's Ayrton Senna, the world champion, his teammate Gerhard Berger, the race winner.
I have to say thank you to Ayrton. We switch over place. And I think it's very nice to know, because a lot of times I was in a situation where I had to take care of, where I was in the difficult part of the game. And it's very nice to know that if it's the other way around, it comes also from the teammate. So it will be no problem at all for the future. If you know both sides are working the same, then I think it will be good for the next year too.
Coming off the podium, surprise, surprise, Ron Dennis getting his own back for a season of soakings. Good to see a title battle that ended with smiles. The last race of the season in Adelaide, South Australia, home of the Australian Grand Prix since 1985. A street circuit with incredibly fast sections that give it the character of a purpose-built track. Ferrari had decided to terminate Alain Prost's contract because of his repeated open criticism of the team's performance. A sad way to finish a relationship between two of the sport's big names, though it had never been comfortable.
We are upset because we've lost, as Ferrari, one of the best driver and the best test driver of the Formula One. The reason was the behavior of Alain Prost was not at the level that Ferrari would like for his top driver.
It was a move that shocked the Adelaide public. They'd been looking forward to welcoming back the twice winner of their Grand Prix. Ferrari called in their test driver, Gianni Morbidelli, to take Prost's place. Morbidelli had spent the season driving for the Minardi team. The gap left there was filled by the Brazilian, Roberto Moreno. Minardi, his third different team of the season after Benetton and Jordan. Another popular driver made a return. Bertrand Gachot took over from the injured Eric Bernard at Larousse. Bernard, fully recovered, should be back next season. The pressure was supposed to be off. It was the last race of the season, but it was an incident-filled practice. Tarquini crashed the Fondmetal, just as he did in Japan. Alessandro Zanardi, over-exuberance in the Jordan. Explain that to your team manager. Carl Wendlinger in the Leighton House, the young Austrian, finding the Adelaide circuit quite demanding. Nigel Mansell enjoys the Adelaide circuit, but he didn't like this much. And Gianni Morbidelli tested the Ferrari's resilience. A nasty accident for Aguri Suzuki in the LaRousse. The end of a long, hard season where he hasn't finished a race in the last 14. Out of the cockpit and okay to resume. The Dallara of JJ Leto in trouble. Michael Schumacher in the Benetton attempting to go over the top of Mark Blundell's Brabham. By contrast, a graceful spin from Riccardo Patrese in the Williams. Stefano Modena in the Tyrrell. The car a mess, the driver fortunately okay. Seemingly untroubled, the new world champion came through to claim his 60th pole position. The record goes higher.
It's very tough, you know, because Gerhard is driving very well, the cars are similar. Williams is also in a similar level, so it's very difficult to maintain the level required to beat everybody else.
Every November, Adelaide comes alive for the Grand Prix. The normally sleepy city turns itself into one huge party, everyone with a part to play. Half an hour before the race, a rainstorm blew in, triggering memories of the controversial Grand Prix of 89.
By the time the grid formed up, the rain was torrential. There'd been a lot of talk about whether the race should run. But the crowd were waiting, the TV stations were waiting. So with the Constructors' Championship still open, the race got underway. 15,000 horsepower scrabbling for grip, and they were off, with Senna and Berger leading the field, as expected. But Mansell and the Benettons were up there too, with Alesi, Patrese and Morbidelli following. Quite a Ferrari baptism for Gianni Morbidelli. Conditions were impossible, visibility non-existent. But somehow Mansell got past Berger into second place and started to catch Senna. Piquet showed there was no grip at all, but this little pirouette didn't even lose him fourth place. The ever-determined Mansell was soon on Senna's tail. But as he dived out of the spray to go alongside, a marshal's warning wave told of wreckage ahead. Lerini and Alesi had crashed on the straight, and Mansell only just saw the wreckage of the Lamborghini in time and pulled in behind Senna again. Still, in these impossible conditions, Mansell kept the pressure up. No grip on the straight sent Martini's Minardi straight into the wall. And now the rain was coming down harder than ever, and everyone was wondering why the race hadn't been stopped. There's Mansell out of control in the spray behind Senna and backwards into the barriers. As Senna went on alone, Mansell's car was in the wall, with Nigel still in the cockpit. Berger, now second, had a major spin, but rejoined. But now Senna had had enough. He was waving frantically for the race to be stopped. And at last, out came the red flag. But Berger, walking home, had had another huge spin. And how he didn't hit anyone this time is a mystery. Mansell was being helped into a medical van in pain from an injured foot. Afterwards, he was very angry that the race hadn't been stopped earlier.
Everything was okay other than it was a complete joke. I mean, there was debris all over the place, and I don't know whether I got a puncture or whether I ran over something, but the car just instantly went out of control. it might act we're playing, but you know, I've been through the corner in Senna's tracks time and time again, television will show, and he just threw me straight into the wall, left hand, and it was a big hit. Well, I'm speechless because, you know, there's a truck down the straight, there's four cars down the straight. The race should have, they had 10 laps to stop the race when that accident happened. There's debris all over the place. I mean, people getting punches. I mean, I just don't know. And I mean, I've hurt myself. I mean, my foot is really bad now. And I've got a headache like there's no tomorrow. So I probably had a little bit of concussion. But I mean, I can't say anymore. I just don't understand.
I think it doesn't really matter whether they start or don't start the race. We've won the Constructors' Championship because Williams needed to win. But I think we did a reasonable job this year. We were leading this race as well, and we win and lose world championships in 16 races, not one. It would have just been nice to have a better show at the end.
And after a pause to see if the weather would relent, the race was finally abandoned for good.
Half points for the curtailed Grand Prix, but another win for Ayrton Senna. Nigel Mansell appropriately second, Nelson Piquet in his last Benetton race in the points, and a good start for Morbidelli at Ferrari. The absentee on the podium, Nigel Mansell. After a medical check, he went straight to the airport. Adelaide, an anticlimax for everyone, including Senna.
Well, I don't think that was a race, first of all, because it was just a matter of staying on the circuit and was not a point to try to go quick at all, and it was impossible. We had a race, very bad one here a couple of years ago, and then was impossible, and today was even worse. There was even more water on the back straight, and you could see that all cars were flying away, flying off, hitting the wall, and surely if I was in the lead, I had a little more visibility and I could take my time to make sure I would stay on the circuit, but it was just one of those things. I managed to stay on the circuit, but it wasn't a race at all.
Despite the damp ending in Adelaide, it was a season that portrayed so much of the very best of the sport. Ayrton Senna's third world title ensures that he'll be ranked among the all-time greats. Nigel Mansell's latest disappointment in his quest for the championship cannot disguise the fact that he's a genuine racing driver, a supreme entertainer for Formula One's millions of fans.
And no sooner had the teams returned from Adelaide than they began testing and developing. Looking ahead to the 1992 season, Formula One never rests.